Smash 2!
God save the queen! She ain't no human being! There is no future! And England's dreaming!
You go back to Ireland every year and the Irish will tell you you're not Irish, but you're brought up in England when you're young and they'll tell you you are Irish. So it's what are you? Are you English? Are you Irish? You're kind of all of it. Oh, the reels and jigs were non-stop. Yeah, a musical household of sorts. I mean, my dad used to be able to play the accordion, but he would never teach me. So, again, that was back to that, won't speak Gaelic, won't play the accordion. He, when he was very young, he played in a show bands, apparently from 12 to 14. I'm glad he didn't teach me the accordion, if you think about it. It could have been well naff. Anarchy on the accordion. Finsbury Park has such a melting pot. Not only all these different structures like skinheads and tralala and like the Jamaicans that came in, the Turks that came in, the Greeks. It's how we mixed up each other. The music, I mean, the music was in my family, but not only that, but in my community. Reggae, born and raised with it, practically. You know, you didn't have to come from Jamaica to understand it, because it was in you, it was inherent. You'd hear it at a very early age, and you grew up with it, and you grew up with it developing from ska. So you knew exactly what it was all about.
They just love sound. They like using any sound. I mean, like, right down to, like, that culture single. Car horns, babies crying, I mean, why not? I mean, it's only sound music, isn't it? Isn't it? Sound like sound.
The experience of growing up Irish in the UK is that it has a sense of perpetually being on the outside. On the one hand, you're on the outside of the so-called indigenous community, of which you're identified as being Irish. And of course, when you come back, as many did every summer, purely economically motivated, to send the children back to spend the summer with grandparents, they were identified particularly by how they spoke.
I mean, my granddad, he was in the Irish army, you know, against the English, and my mum's parents would never speak to us. So they viewed us as English, and so there'd be a lot of Gaelic wobbling in the house, and my mum and dad decided at a very early age, for instance, that they would never speak Gaelic outside of Ireland. But you go back to Ireland every year and the Irish will tell you you're not Irish, but you're brought up in England when you're young and they'll tell you you are Irish. So it's what are you? Are you English? Are you Irish? You're kind of all of it. In many ways, it would have been a problem to me when I was younger because, you know, you kind of end up lacking identity and you're looking for something to hook onto and say, I'm a part of that, I'm a part of that.
Lydon, in his autobiography, which is, of course, entitled No Irish, No Blacks, No Dogs, talks about being called a dirty Irish bastard. He talks about bricks being thrown at Irish Catholic kids in North London. So Lydon was definitely on the receiving end of anti-Irish prejudice. And in fact, the very first study of the second generation Irish was conducted in 1970 at a North London school, which John Lydon was attending at the time. And what came out of that study was the fact that most second generation Irish kids in North London in 1970 felt neither Irish nor English, but somewhere between the two. And in a way, that's come out in Lydon's work. And his personality and his career. So when Lydon has gone to Ireland, he's often felt excluded. He's felt that he was rejected, which is a classic second generation Irish thing. You feel Irish, you go home to Ireland, and you're seen as English.
It's a fantastic place, though, to go when you were young. Mental. And having an English background and sensibility, we'll say clothes-wise, you'd stand out very, very seriously. But that was all right, because I didn't know no different. I just thought people always treated me that way. And more or less that is the truth. I don't seem to blend in well with any society. Look at the way you dress, look at your hair. I mean, I went from extremes, right? At 16, I had hair down to here. At 17, I had it cut way short, almost cropped, but dyed bright green. And as my dad said at the time, I looked like a Brussels sprout. Man got kicked out of home at that time for that. But that was all right too, because I'd already earned me money, you know. I knew how to be independent. I knew how to look out for myself. So I went squatting with Sid.
Lydon's introduction to the Pistols was partly fortuitous. Malcolm McLaren, the mastermind in some ways behind the idea of the Pistols, was desperately searching for a lead singer, and he couldn't find one. Typical of McLaren was the fact that he wasn't after somebody that could actually sing. The image was more important to him.
Apparently it all started because I had on a Pink Floyd t-shirt, which I used an indelible ink marker on, and I wrote "I hate" across the top and shredded it up so it was full of holes. And I wouldn't wear flares. And that apparently impressed Malcolm and the boys, and they wanted to meet me. They didn't like me when they met me, and I didn't want them to either. Perfect. Rehearsal, and then we were out touring. We never thought anybody would be listening to this, never thought we'd amount to much at all, other than great fun and a good chance to write a song or two about all the things that would be making me angry.
Punk in England in the late 1970s was very much a scene made up of misfits and outsiders. And I think if you were second generation Irish in 1970s London, in the late 70s particularly, you would have been attracted to punk. And I think the fact that John Lydon was at the forefront of punk was an interesting thing for other second generation Irish kids. So people like Shane McGowan of the Pogues and Kevin Rowland of Dex's Midnight Runners have said the fact that punk had at its forefront a second generation Irish singer who was very open about his Irishness attracted them to become punk musicians.
He was a voice for the intelligent, the questioning, the rebellious working class kids, and they were the ones who were Irish, because they came from this strange culture that they didn't understand. They were descended from people kicked out of their own country for being poor to come and be poor over here and hit that bottom rung of the ladder here. And then they got that helping hand up, you know, from like Catholic schools and all the rest, educationally wise, but still didn't quite fit in, you know, because they weren't English and they had a different mindset from the English.
And I think there was still a lot of prejudice against Irish people in the 70s. You know, it wasn't that long before that you'd had guest houses with the sign "No Irish, No Blacks." There was a lot of suspicion of Irish people because the IRA was still very active in Britain at the time. So you're in this curious position of feeling like an outsider and a rebel just because of who you are. And punk was really attractive to people like me, people like John Lydon. You know, a lot of punks, I think, enjoyed the fact that here's a place where I can actually be myself and express feelings of rebellion, discontent, outsiderness, but also celebrate the feeling of being an outsider, that it was something that gave you, there was a feeling of being unique as well, that it gave you a different kind of identity, that you didn't have to fit into the cultural mainstream? Because you never really fitted in anyway.
Songs, I love words. My songs are full of them. My best songs are in pill. This is what I do. It's how I communicate with the world, is through song, and hopefully I'm being accurate in what I sing and what I do and how I transmit that. It's a difficult thing, but my God, it beats working with a shovel on the building site.
It's funny the way things pan out, but you know, when you go back to Lydon's childhood and the anecdote about his grandfather being displeased about his Cockney accent and the fact that he didn't quite fit into Ireland because of the way he spoke, you know, decades later, when he got involved in a fracas in Dublin and ended up in Mountjoy Prison.
Go to Ireland for my brother's band, the 4B2s. Went to around the corner to the local pub, just there off the Liffey River, and straight away, two policemen decided to have a word with me about the way I was dressed or looked, and, you know, choice phraseologies like English bastard were floating around. One thing led to another, but not because of me or anything I did, and found myself arrested and locked up in Mountjoy and facing quite some serious time for it. The presumption was that I was a smart-ass Englishman come over to Ireland just to take the piss out of the paddies, and, you know, when the endless troop of aunts and uncles and family members and Irish lawyers that are part of my family were presented to the court, it became completely apparent that that assumption was wrong.
I am John, and I was born in London. I am no vulture, this is my culture.
Look, I've been banned from Ireland most of my life. I've never been able to play there, so Irish people don't understand what on earth it is I'm getting up to. It was very difficult when I took the Sex Pistols there at that time. The audience were thinking, look, they're all wearing Union Jacks and, like, you know, this is some kind of, like, British fascist takeover of Ireland. It's not at all that. I was surprised at the ignorance of a lot of the audience. Don't they know what an Irishman's done for Britain? And yet, am I Irish? I don't know, but I have Irish in me. I think Irish, and I also think English. I don't see us as being that different from each other. And my world experience has always been that. Both mum and dad are dead now. I'm always thinking, what would they think? What would that mean to them? And a lot of the stuff I've done over the years has been, you know, challenging to them as parents. But they always kind of grasped it and got it eventually. My mum and dad would both say, you know, that's Johnny, from a very early age. And I was quite chuffed with them for that, and I loved them to death. You know, Johnny will work it out.
Cannot explain us, and that's what makes us. We are the ageless, we are teenagers. We are the focus out of the hopeless. We are the last chance, we are the last dance.
It's interesting to think, I mean, people often speculate as to whether John Lydon would have become Johnny Rotten if he'd grown up in Tuam, or if Johnny Marr would have become a kind of godlike musician if he'd stayed in Athy in County Kildare. And in a way, I think the truth is their parents brought something with them to these English cities, and these kids grew up with a very strong sense of Irish culture and music. But that met with the kind of English pop culture in a very complex and interesting way. Could be wrong. I could be right. May the road rise with you. May the road rise with you. May the road rise with you.
I know where my mum and dad come from, and I know that that's in me. And it ain't for no one out there to tell me any different. I know that my English background is in me, and I'm all the more proud for it too, just as I am my mum and dad. But all of these things have added to my personality, not taken away. I'm very far from being a cliche, and let's hope it continues that way. So all that anger and energy becomes something to use as a tool to explain, firstly, to myself, who and what I am in the world, but hopefully to other people too. So that what are or seem like insurmountable problems to you of trying to fit in, it's don't try to fit in, just try to be yourself.
You thought you'd gotten rid of us, didn't you? But you were wrong, old bean, because we're back with a vengeance.
God save the Queen, my son.
God Save the Queen is one of the most extraordinary moments in the history of British popular music, released to coincide with the Queen's Silver Jubilee, in which he takes a stance against the Jubilee, which is very unfashionable at the time, a very unfashionable stance.
Power, the status quo, it can never ever be shifted until you stand up and say something about it and make it look ridiculous. I thought God Save the Queen explained the royal family rather nicely.
To me, God Save the Queen is probably the most exciting pop record ever made, and it's totally incendiary. That was now, and a band came under that now, it was still freaking people out. Because that level of intensity, you just don't see that much, you know, when something truly is dangerous. You know, you look at Lydon's eyes, and it's dangerous. It's psychotic, isn't it? It's a psychotic performance. It's somewhere else, isn't it? It's all that frustration, but all that burning, amazing intelligence.
People are sick and fed up of this country, telling them what to do.
But not getting paid for it.
Pardon?
But not getting paid for putting on that sort of public show.
Well, nor are we. We ain't even being allowed to play.
They weren't the most harmonious bunch, let's put it that way. That was always going to be a problem. There was always going to be conflict, some conflict between the membership. It was a very volatile situation, particularly when everything that they did was so commented upon by the press, by the media, and the vilification that was shown towards them by sections of the public. I mean, particularly after making God Save the Queen, you know, they were attacked in the street.
I always thought the Pistols was great fun, a comedy act, really. You know, not to be taken quite so viciously. I mean, God, the mindset that used to work against us was brutal and violent and dark and evil. But that just made us stronger for a certain amount of time. Then the media has its influence, and certain people started to take their image more important than the fun aspect of it, and that became a real problem.
Right. One, two, three, four!
Sid becomes completely infected by the idea of what the Pistols are, and it totally utterly destroys Sid Vicious, and destroyed the band as well. And you put them on the road in America, and you've had it then, because the pressures just go more and more intense.
The drugs killed Sid. But Sid had a real problem anyway. I mean, his mother was a registered heroin addict. He didn't really stand much of a chance in life with that as a background. He could have made wiser decisions, yes, but Sidney wasn't a very clever chap. But great fun, and I miss him to high hell.
Sex Pistols went to America, you know, that was never going to work at the best of times, but, you know, McLaren almost seemed to be sabotaging it. The Pistols could have gone and played maybe New York, played in, you know, venues in the Bowery. They could have played CBGBs, and they got down really well, and the other selected venues, they would have been okay. But to send them off to Texas and you know...
I mean, on paper, the idea of touring all the Southern Bible Belt towns is great because you're going to cause a fuss, it's going to get in all the papers, but you put the band out there with like one bodyguard and the reactions are like really heavy all the gigs and the pressure is really on and Sid was coming off heroin. It's just like, it just sounds like an utterly miserable tour. So when he implodes right at the end in San Francisco after the last gig, it's inevitable, isn't it? But it's a brilliant exit though. It's the best exit of a rock and roll band ever, isn't it? When Lynyrd's on the stage and he's doing that, ha ha ha, have you ever feeling you've been cheated? And that's the end of the gig and the crowd's all throwing rubbish at them. You're watching it when he's staring out at the crowd. And it's quite an emotional moment, it's quite powerful, isn't it? And it's like thinking, wow, that's amazing. And you're actually watching the band and a dream, really, just all fall apart.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
We did enough as Pistols with each other. We couldn't bear each other anymore, really. It was too intense. The pressure was too much. But we're still mates now, those of us that managed to live through it. We're pretty like this. We're pretty like this.